And this is the story. God Indra, having fallen in love with the beautiful Ahalya, wife of Gautaman the sage, sneaks into the hermitage in Gautaman's absence, disguised as him, and sleeps with Ahalya. However, Gautaman returns and curses both Indra, who is instantly covered in a thousand vaginas, Porcha, and Ahalya, who turns into stone. Just before Ahalya is petrified into stone, in answer to her plea that he should set a limit to the curse, he declares that the dust of Rama's feet will one day set her free. The immortals, meanwhile, plead on behalf of Indra, and Gautaman changes the marks all over him into a thousand eyes, and off he goes. I'm giving you Kamban's version, which most, I think, people in the Tamil country would know. Now, this wonderful, long study of the Ahalya story by Professor Kailashapati, who tells us that the earliest reference to the story in Tamil literature is a brief three lines in Paripadal, which is one of the later Sangam collections, so that, you know, it precedes Kamban's 12th century telling by about five centuries. So that is to say, it's a well-known story already. In this version, Paripadal is one of the later Sangam collections containing both Aham and Bhakti poems. And pilgrims on the way to Tiruparankundram, a hill sacred to Murugan and Valli, are shown a number of cave paintings in this particular sequence, which they recognize and explain to each other. The lines that are relevant to us are these. This is Indran in the form of a cat. This is Ahalya. This is Gautama. This is where he turns her into stone in his film. So that stone thing is a long-standing Tamil version, it seems. Yeah.
The cat comes from folk literature.
Apparently,
yes. But she makes the Sanskrit pun, manjaro.
Right, so, right.
My lover, the cat.
Right, right.
So that's also so a very, very old story.
Yes, yes.
Possibly from the north.
Could be. It's interesting how these come into the south, and particularly the stone thing, which becomes, I think we'll all agree, very important in the southern retellings, in the Tamil retellings. One of the major changes we is the content of Gautaman's curse. In Valmiki, Ahalya is condemned to eat no food but air and to lie on burning ashes, invisible to all men. In Kamban, she's turned into stone, as we're saying in this earlier tradition. And the possibility of her deliverance from his curse is conceded by Gautaman after her desperate plea. This symbolism, flesh becoming stone, returning to life, will be used variously and most poignantly by all poets and writers following Kamban who have retold the story. The other crucial change is to do with Ahalya's state of mind when Indra makes love to her. In the Valmiki version, you'll correct me if I'm wrong, although Indra appears in the guise of her husband Gautaman, she recognizes him as the king of the gods, is flattered, and sleeps with him willingly. Kamban's version is much more ambiguous than this. And I want to look at the crucial lines, both in Tamil and in Ramanujan's version. Let's look at Ramanujan's version first, perhaps, and then I'll go back to it. And I'm looking at verses 552 and 553, one day overwhelmed and mindless. One day, overwhelmed and mindless, he isolated the sage and sneaked into the hermitage, wearing the exact body of Gautama, whose heart knew no falsehoods. Sneaking in, he joined Ahalya. Coupled, they drank deep of the clear new wine of first night weddings. And she knew, that's the operative line as far as I'm concerned. Yet, unable to put aside what was not hers, she dallied in her joy. But the sage did not tarry, he came back, very Shiva with three eyes in his head. And I want to read you now the Tamil, which some of you, I'm sure, will pick up, and in any case, I'm going to take you through it very carefully. Mayilara arivu neengi, maamunikku attam seidu, poyyila ullathaan, tan uruvame kondu pukkaan. Pukku, avalodum kaama pudumana maduvin theral, okka undu irudalodum, unarndan. Unarnda pinnum, takkadu anudu, enna oraal taalndanar. Irupattala mukkalana anaya attam munivanum, and if I were to give you a closer translation, it would go like this. Infatuated to the point of losing his common sense, arivu neengi, Indra ensured that the sage was a male and taking the exact form of Gautaman, whose heart knew no falsehood, he sneaked inside. And so they coupled, drinking deep of the clear, honeyed wine at the newly wed. Then suddenly, she realized, unarndanu. I don't know how many of you know this word, unarndanu. But even then, unarnda pinnum, past judging that it was not right, takkadu alla enna oral, she sank, fell utterly, taalndanu. It was then that the sage, equal to Shiva in his power and endurance, returned. Now the two operative words in this passage relating to Ahalya's recognition or otherwise of Indra are unarnanal and oral. Do you know the word unarchi, unarndanal? Yes, you would know.
Even in Malayalam there is unarnanal.
Yes, it is. It's a most crucial word. And oral, oral is to know, to understand. Let us consider this pair of words a little. Kambar
oral, how do you?
Oral
ocean feels right, lighting up a dramatic and terrible moment as Kamban presents it to us. Ramanujan's "she knew," I think, is too unequivocal here. I feel it isn't, it's making a judgment which is not quite there. In contrast to unardal, ordal is to do with the reasoning mind. And Kamban, I think, wants to say that Ahalya's realization comes too late for moral judgment, catching her, as it were, in mid-descent. Takkadu alla enna oral, not able to judge it improper. Taalndanal, she sank. You would know this word, taalndanal? Taalndanal, she sank, she fell, she lowered herself also. It carries all those meanings. What does she sink into? Taalndanal, she sank. What does she sink into? Bliss or sin? Whatever Kamban intended, and there are uneasy questions here about sexual passion and pleasure, I think Ramanujan's dallied in her joy feels at least inadequate to the single word Tharndanar, whose very sound echoes the sense of it. And in Tamil, the two, let me read those two lines again to you. Okka undu irithalodum. Okka, together. Undu, they ate off this clear honeyed love of newly married. Irithalodum, as they were together. Unarndanal. Unarnda pinnum, and there's that pause in the line. Unarndanal. Unarnda pinnum, takkadu andru enna oral. You see the balance between those two words, the pause in the line, it's right. Wonderfully dramatic, and it moves the drama on. Another pause in the line carries the drama. I hope I've laid bare some of the ambiguities. You want to ask any questions about that at the moment? Yes, yes.
I have always had this question about Ahalya. Ahalya is supposed to be Ayonija, isn't it? She's not born out of any yoni or something. Some story is there. No? Anyway, whatever it is, her father gave her in marriage to this man, Sage.
Yes, yes.
She was a young woman, and the Sage is a very ascetic kind
yes,
of a character.
Yes, yeah.
So I'm sure her sexual passions were not completely fulfilled.
Yeah.
This is what I
yeah.
feel.
Shall we take larger questions like this later and just look at, you know,
yeah.
textual questions, because we will have space at the end. Basanti, do you
okay.
mind?
No, don't mind. All I wanted to say is, I feel so, she was, there was a willingness on her part to get into her this thing.
Well, it's ambiguous, I think, and all those questions will be contained. What I want to say, I think, importantly, is that Kamban leaves the space for those mm-hmm. questions. You know, it's not she knew just like that, and then it's so much more complex that, because he catches her, describes these different moments in the whole sequence of the encounter between these two. Asha, did you?
I have a translation question. Do you want me to hold it till later?
If it's immediate, and we'll, yeah. yeah.
And she knew, that's the...
That's his, yes.
The Raman thing of and she knew, a little bit in defense of Raman.
Okay, all right. Yes.
But I think the and is critical. You know, to, I think it sort of bridges these two very different kind
yes,
of perceptions
yes,
of knowledge
yes,
that you're talking about, the
yes,
cerebral one and the more visceral
yes,
one.
Yes, yes.
And I think the and she knew is, again, plays on that very folkloric idea of no two men may love the same way.
Yep.
So
sure, 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 sure.
The truth that you realize, there's a sexual truth that you realize, which becomes a personal truth at that moment where precisely you can't withdraw any longer. So I think the Raman is actually...
The dalied with her joy is just, I don't know what happened to him, it's just completely off. But
and persuasive,
yes, 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 and Tharndhanal, which is so very moving, really. And she knew, I think it's open to...
If you are translating, what would you
want? No, I can't answer that, because I hate being put on the spot like that, because you have to play with it to get to it. You know, you have to try so many things before you find a solution, if at all you do. So I'd rather not do that. May I move on? And then I know there will be lots of questions, but for the moment, I hope we've looked at some of the ambiguities in Kamban's telling. And of course, not surprisingly, Kamban's commentators and critics have debated endlessly about the extent of Ahalya's guilt or not. But the whole incident, it also seems to me, could be read as a tale about how we make moral choices and decisions and how responsible we are for them and when. For example, Indran is described as Mayilala Arivulingi. Mayilala, Mayil is the old word for infatuation. And you know Arivu Ningi, he's lost his head, he's lost his common sense. And yet, he is held responsible for his immoral deed, action, and punished for it. Or so it appears, until the gods intercede for him, and then he gets away with it. So what is that about? And then there is Gautaman. In modern times, Gautaman's part in the tragedy has also come into scrutiny. If Ahalya is not guilty, how are we then to read Gautaman's curse and his excessive anger? In Kamban, his words are unequivocal. He says, "You who are like a prostitute, turn now into stone." The word he uses is vilaimahal ni, which Ramanujan renders very successfully as bought woman. Yet when Vishwamitra advised Vilaimahal, he calls her a Vilaimahal, which in Sangam times is always the word used for prostitute. She sells herself. When Vishwamitra advises Gautaman after she's freed from the curse, he says, "She did not err in her heart, take her back. Nenjinar pirai pilladal." While Rama hands her to Gautaman as that woman of flawless chastity, Ma Saru Katpin Mikka Alanginai. how are we to read Kamban here? Either he means that Ahalya was guiltless always, or that she was purified during her long years as a stone, so she's then given back as a pure and chaste woman. Rama alone, it seems to me, in Kamban's version, to be free of ambiguity. Indeed, it is one of the moments in Kamban's telling when his divinity is very clearly revealed by Vishwamitra. But, of course, he isn't so, he doesn't get off scot-free in modern tellings. There are critical rewrites of Rama, of course. I now want to come to some modern Tamil tellings of the Ahalya story. And I want to begin with a curious rendering of the story which simplifies and resolves these ambiguities. This is Subramanya Mudaliar's Ahalikai Venba, and because it's a curiosity, it's interesting. Ahalikai Venba. Ahalikai is the Tamil version of Ahalya. 1914 it is. And I want to tell you very quickly about this. Mudaliar shifts the interest of the story to Indran and the scene between Indran and Ahalya. He loves the seduction scene, which he presents as a straightforward rape. In his introduction, and you will be delighted to hear this, he acknowledges his debt to Shakespeare's The Rape of Lucrece. Now, I don't know how many of you know The Rape of Lucrece. It was one of Shakespeare's earliest works, and not madly brilliant, 1594. And it tells the story of the Roman king, Tarquin, and his rape of Lucretia, a woman well known for her beauty and chastity. Tarquin enters Lucretia's bedroom while her husband is away in an army camp, which he has contrived, and then attempts to seduce her. Lucretia speaks up, appealing to his sense of morality and his respectability as an authority figure, but he rapes her anyway, overwhelming her by brute force. Now, the crucial thing, after he leaves, Lucretia sends for her father and her husband, tells them everything, and makes them promise to avenge her, after which she commits suicide. Mudaliar takes many elements from Shakespeare's poem, particularly the debate in Lucretia's bedroom, making the confrontation between Indran and Ahalya a dramatic clash between good and evil. Indran makes clear his intent. Ahalya is the embodiment of chastity, opposes him entirely. There are no grounds for doubt here. The debate also gives Ahalya a lively character. She stands up for herself and defends herself as best she can, so she's a much stronger character. It's also notable, in fact, it's very important, that when Indran finally overcomes her, with his superior strength, Ahalya has lost consciousness entirely, she's fainted. In this way, Mudaliar exonerates her, you see, completely. Yet the fact remains that she has been raped. We note that Ahalya still feels guilty, still reviles herself to Gautaman when he returns, declaring that she's not even fit to be his slave. And although Gautaman comforts her, saying that everything that has happened is through the working of fate, Urvinayal, nevertheless, he can't accept her because she, as a victim of rape, she still is tainted. He proclaims that she must become a stone in order to receive purification. Kallaini ardal karvayam, you will wash yourself free of your taint, having become a stone. I'm interested to see how firmly Subramanya Mudaliar boxes the Ahalya story into a frame of late Victorian morality with an intense preoccupation with female chastity and yet a sort of prurient fascination with the seduction scene. At the same time, the Ahalya story also gets bound up with a reformist consciousness of the victimization of women. And hand in hand with this goes a mix of horror, shared male guilt, and a moral evasiveness in regard to women who are victims of rape. And all these themes, I think, continue in various ways in modern reworkings of the story. But I want really to move on now to two really wonderful treatments of the Ahalya story in more modern times. The first by one of our finest short story writers in Tamil, Pudumai Pittan. The other by the Sri Lankan poet Sivasagaran. Pudumai Pittan actually wrote two versions of the Ahalya story. The first, written in 1934, has the simple title Ahalihai. The second, written 9 years later, is called Saba Vimochanam, and it's a very famous Saba Vimochanam, deliverance from the curse. And although I want really to focus on the second and more famous story, the earlier and quite different version has its own interest, so let me describe it briefly. The earlier work tells the actual story of the seduction rape of Ahalya, which, as I mentioned earlier, seems to be of endless fascination, seen here as exemplifying the destructive power of passion, but with an odd twist of its own. Only three characters appear: Ahalya, Gautaman, Indra. Indran is seen as almost entirely human. There are only a couple of oblique references to his divinity. He sees Ahalya when she's bathing in the river and has already made advances to her and been repulsed. He then stalks her, follows her up to the hut, gets rid of Gautaman by imitating the crowing of a cock, and seduces her when she's half asleep. She's completely taken in and only recognizes him as the stalker when she opens her eyes. The interesting thing that Pudumai Pittan has done in this early version is to change the character of Gautaman entirely and to make him the chief protagonist. No longer the furious sage, he's excessively and perhaps unnaturally calm, the opposite of passionate Indran, certainly less passionate and sensuous than his wife. When he returns to the hut, realizing that it's not yet dawn, he finds Ahalya in a terrible state. Pudumai Pittan describes her as squirming and shaking like a worm that has been dropped into fire. And Indran still standing there, the very picture of guilt. Gautaman's reaction is astounding, to say the least. He says to Ahalya, calmly gathering her up and with a terrible prescience, "Kanne Ahalya, darling Ahalya, at that moment, did your body become a feelingless stone?" Meaning, could you not have did your body give out on you? Did you not recognize him at all? Could you not? He apparently deduces a new truth, that passion turns even a god into an animal. Still serene, he sends Indran on his way. There isn't a curse. The story ends with a cryptic and hugely ambiguous comment by the author. I should read that to you in Tamil. It's an extraordinary thing. And what if Ahalya? Ahalya? Avan ullathil nihandha ooriyin irudhi koothu kanavanin saandhikku pagaipalamaga nindrathu. And it's like fate's final trick, which was played out in her heart, became the battleground of her husband's serenity. An extraordinary thing to say. Fate's final trick, which was played out in her heart, presented itself as the battleground of her husband's serenity. What is this fate's final trick? Is it that she turns into stone? What is her realization that at last brings Gautaman's serenity to the battleground? I mean, up till now, he's been this unnatural, astoundingly unnatural sage. And suddenly he's confronted, his serenity is completely thrown into the battleground? What is it? He doesn't say. Is it that her realization of Indran's passion, is it that she turns into stone? What is this trick that fate plays on her? Yes?
I have an alternative suggestion for the meaning of that line, did your body turn to feel into a stone at that moment? Perhaps what he's asking her is, did you enjoy it? And if that is the case, then the serenity has
been thrown into. But he is so unnaturally calm. He's comforting her. He picks her up and he says,
I think she finds it more insulting than anything else than comforting her. I would say that.
One of the earlier, before court, what Arshia said, were earlier versions of court proceeding, one of the main arguments against the victims are a lot of cases dismissed by saying that you enjoyed it.
Yes, indeed.
That you participated.
Yeah, and then is that the whole law is changed it later.
So
morally, the whole concept of rape is looked in that perspective.
Right, did you enjoy it? But he's putting it in the other way, isn't he? Did your body turn into stone? Is that to do with recognition, or what was your experience? He's actually
Right and which is wrong is the question here.
He is comforting her. He doesn't curse. He sends off Indran, and then there is this sudden turnaround entirely.
But you know, if she was not turned into stone, she would be constantly the subject of this man's suspicion all the time.
But there is no curse.
But it's better to be cursed as a stone.
That is
ambiguity.
Yeah, it's a hugely ambiguous ending.
Budhumipitan
is indeed very clever, but it's the focus of the story, which has all along been on this man's excessive calm, and suddenly the turnaround. Which is not at the moment when he comes back to discover his wife in this terrible, and she's already told him there is the stalker. I can't see, because he's been stalking her, and she comes back and tells him there is this awful fellow who's stalking me, and he says, you can't help your beauty. People will desire you.
So, the case of this man asking the woman at the end, did you enjoy it?
I don't think it's quite as simple as that.
But when he said, did your body become stone, he's demanding that that kind of reaction from her. It's almost like a whole...
He's...
Reassurance for him, saying that you should have been stone, that's...
At least if you had been stone, it's all right.
Possibly. I'm not entirely convinced because of the tenor of the story.
He reversed the curse with this line.
It is terribly prescient. It is terribly prescient. And Pudhumipitan knows what he's doing by putting precisely those words into Gautama's mouth. And he knows the story too well. It's almost a wish there, which then happens later. But how we are to read this final line, I just...
Can you read the line again, please, about the fate, the final trick?
Yes.
Fate's
final trick, which was played out in her heart. Aval ullathil nihanda uriin irudhi kutu. Kanavanan sandikku pagai palamaha nindadu. It became the battleground. It stood, nindadi, it stood as, but it's presented as the battleground to her husband's serenity. Kanavanin sandig, his serenity, his peace. Mm-hmm. It is shattered entirely. But you know, there is the space between, you know, he sends Indra off, Indra poiva, Indar Gautaman. He sends him off that way. Even then, his mind is clearly serene. Avar manadil sandi telivaha therindadu. And then the whole story shifts to Ahalya. And Ahalya, and you suddenly see it from Ahalya's point of view, and it's then that he is shattered. So I think this is more complex, and I want to leave it like that. I think it's not a simple moral
tale. But when he said this, I think Ahalya's heart already turned into a stone.
Well, he could have done. But this is we are not allowed. We are not allowed to make that judgment. We are not allowed by Pudhumepithan. That easy way out. He leaves you thinking about this. But the second, I hope I'm not taking too much time over this. The second version, which is very much more complex, I want to take up now. It's prefaced, Sabha Vimochanam, 1943, by the deliberately provocative epigraph, and I quote, "For those acquainted with the Ramayana, this story might be incomprehensible, unpalatable too. I'm not concerned about that," he says, and then he goes straight into his story. He begins exactly at the same place that Kamban does. Rama and Lakshmana, godchildren, avatara shishukal, arrive with Vishwamitra outside the walls of Mithila. Rama's mission of deliverance is hinted at. They have already begun the destruction of the Rakshasas. There's some irony in the reference to Marichi here, who Vishwamitra imagines has disappeared forever. After the dust of Rama's feet settles upon Ahalya and she returns to life and worships Rama, Vishwamitra tells the prince who she is. But here her story is not given in detail, but summarized in just a couple of sentences. She is, according to Vishwamitra, that artless girl, Pede, who was deceived by Indra's magical disguise, Maya Vesham. As a result of her unbounded love for her husband, Alavukku Adangada Pasithin Vilaivaha, she allowed herself to be deceived and her body to be tainted. Then Udambai Masupaditthi Kondaval. Vishwamitra could almost be summarizing Pudhumepithan's earlier story. Importantly, in both Pudhumepithan's versions, Ahalya does not recognize Indra. Her unbounded, excessive, or uncontrollable alavukku adangada love for her husband is clearly not deemed a sin either by Rama, who asks himself, should someone be punished for something that happened without the assent of her conscious will, nor by Vishwamitra, who says to Gautama, echoing Kamban exactly, it's only right that you accept her. She did not err in her heart. Now the rest of Pudhumepithan's Sabha Vimochanam shifts to the continuing life of Ahalya and Gautaman and re-examines Rama's impact on the couple. So we've now got Rama as a main player. In this way, all the main events of the Ramayana story are retold from the perspective of this middle-aged and disillusioned couple. Their great hopes in the prospect of coronation, which was to begin a golden age of Dharma, and which goes disastrously wrong. Then the exile of Rama and Sita, and finally their long-awaited return. Sabha Vimochanam effectively has two endings. The first is when Sita tells Ahalya of the fire test that Rama imposed on her. Ahalya is outraged. Kannagi's frenzy leaping through her mind, Pudhumepithan comments. One law for Ahalya, quite another for Rama, she asks. In the case of Ahalya, the purity of her intention made Rama absolve her, even if technically she could be said to be at fault, having actually slept with Indra. But in the case of Sita, even though neither her chastity nor the purity of her intention were ever in doubt, within the terms of Pudhumepithan's story at any rate, Yet Rama could not accept her without establishing the fact of her innocence publicly. And I quote this bit. "Didn't it have to be proved to the world?" Sita asked, laughing softly. "If one knows it oneself, isn't that enough? Is it possible to prove the truth to the world?" demanded Ahalya. She was dry of words. Again she said, "And will it become the truth if you just demonstrate it, even if it doesn't touch the heart?" Ahalya's encounter with Rama at the start of Pudumaipittan's story gives her a criterion by which to judge him at the end, and judge him she does. This is an ironic reversal of Kamban's Ramayana, where, as Ramanujan has said, the Ahalya episode is the first in a series of actions through which Rama roots out evil, sustains the good, and brings release to all things. Here he's the opposite, in a sense. The second ending happens when Gotaman returns to the hut and embraces Ahalya, trying one last time to revive their relationship. But Ahalya, shocked by what she perceives as Rama's betrayal, has turned in her mind to the earlier deceptions and betrayals in her life. She does not see Gotaman when he enters, but Indra, disguised as Gotaman. Her heart hardens, and she wills herself into stone once more. And this, Pudumaipittan implies, is the real deliverance from the curse of long ago. An important element that Pudumaipittan introduces into Saba Vimochanam is its psychological subtlety. At the start of Pudumaipittan's retelling of the Ahalya story, Rama and Lakshmana are clearly described as children descended from the gods. But the story leaves behind its mythic background and becomes a human one. Unlike previous retellings of the Ahalya story, in the Tamil tradition anyway, Rama becomes an important player in the story. He's studied in terms of a young man trained to be an ideal ruler who shows great promise but fails in the end. At the level of the human story, the psychological examination of what happens to the marriage between Ahalya and Gotaman is another new perspective that Pudumaipittan brings to the story. The trauma of the sexual deception practiced on her and the terrible curse which Gotaman once pronounced are long-lasting, gradually driving a wedge between the couple. Pudumaipittan implies that they could never have survived it. The way this theme is developed is one of the finest things in the story. Unable to find any peace, Ahalya and Gotaman undertake a pilgrimage which parallels the years of exile and wandering of Rama and Sita. But the landscape merely reflects their inner Pali, wasteland, aridity, wherever they go. And I should explain that Pali is the fifth of the five landscapes, each associated with an aspect of love, which underlie the poetics of the Aham, or a love poetry of Sangam Tamil. Pali is desert waste and stands for separation. We cannot be certain whether Pudumaipittan is deliberately referring to Aham poetry, but it seems to me there are clear parallels between the inner and outer landscape in the Saba Vimochanam, which echo the classical Tamil poems. And this Pali thing is heartbreaking. So this long pilgrimage through arid landscape all the time, the one thing they look forward to is Rama's return. And when eventually the story of the fire test is told, Ahalya's hope in the possibility of another and more daring definition of Dharma is finally lost. The symbolism of stone is deployed with acuteness and force. At the beginning, it is a punishment for passion. At the end, a voluntary withdrawal in protest of all kinds of betrayal. One of the important things in Pudumaipittan's version is, of course, the importance he gives to the intention underlying the deed. Not only do Rama and Vishwamitra stress this position at the beginning of the story, it entirely influences and changes Gotaman's perspective after the curse is lifted. To my knowledge, Pudhumaipithan is the first retell of the Ahalya story in Tamil, also to develop Gautaman's character at any length. He's quite fascinated by that Gautaman character, so that in the earlier version he tries to change him entirely from this angry sage into this excessively serene, calm sage. So he's playing with that character. Here it's a Gautaman who learns. After Ahalya and Gautaman are reunited, that is after the curse is lifted, Gautaman begins to think of Dharma in an entirely new way. And I quote, "If a violation of the moral law happens without one's awareness or assent, then it cannot be judged as sin, even though the entire seed of man is crushed because of it. It's the deeds we do with the full intention of the conscious mind. Mane laipum suya prajnayum kudiya seyal. It is such a deed that mark us." It has to be said that in Pudhumaipithan's version, Gautaman learns this new truth cerebrally, but Ahalya experientially. So in Sabha Vimochanam, Pudhumaipithan takes up the question of intention and agency, not as one which belongs only to modern times, but as an abiding one, which then enables us to reread the Ahalya story in a new and relevant way. But Sabha Vimochanam also asks a larger question about what constitutes dharma in the public sphere. What does dharma mean for a ruler or head of state? How was it that the shocking events in Ayodhya, resulting in Rama's and Sita's exile, were allowed to happen? What is this dharma that allows a Bharata to be so engrossed in it that he cannot forgive his mother, Kaikeyi? Ahalya's realization, even before Rama's return from Sri Lanka, is that, and I quote, "A dharma which takes no account of individual human beings is the enemy of the human race." I mean, she puts it quite strongly. Then she encounters the inconsistency in Rama himself. As the radiant godchild, Rama could see with clarity that each deed must be judged by the individual doer's intention. Yet later, as the ideal ruler trained by Vasishtha, he sets aside individual rights and puts the state and public interest first. Here, Pudhumaipithan is raising the whole question of the basis of moral action, dharma, in the context of the individual and the state, and placing individual responsibility and accountability above established rules and practices. And he's very, very clear about this. I just want to mention a long polemical essay, Ungal Kadai, which he wrote, which brings together many of the ideas that are reflected in his stories consistently and are of importance in Sabha Vimochanam. First of all, he presents, this is Pudhumaipithan, the history of man as a constant struggle for survival. According to him, it's because of the struggle for survival that human societies grew, governments and religions developing later as ways of safeguarding those societies. Crucially, he sees an irreconcilable contradiction between the individual and society. The individual he sees as always being sacrificed for the sake of society. Hence, he declares his lack of faith in most political philosophers and their systems, because the ideal societies they have imagined have not taken into account the individual and his weaknesses. He writes, "So long as man is man, society and the individual must stand in two different corners, debating their position." And his suspicion of organized religion is similar. "Governments seek to fetter man's body," he writes. "Religions seek to fetter man's mind." In both cases, to be enslaved by a doctrine, kolgei, is to be enslaved by the monstrously huge forms we have raised in the sacrificial fires we ourselves have lit. The central irony for Pudumaipithan is that society is created by gods and their notions of heaven and hell according to their own needs, but then became enslaved by them. And it's only by destroying the gods of our own making that we can prepare the way for genuine change. It's this stance that underlies his skepticism and agnosticism. And you know, it's there in all his work, and I think it's there in a very wonderful way in his retelling. So I'll leave that now and go to Sivasagaram's poem, which you've got. Sivasagaram's poem, I think it's 1983 or 4, is one of the most economical treatment of the story in Tamil that I know of. It's only the title that Ahalya, or indeed any of the four characters taking part in the drama of the poem, is named. But the name immediately signals to the story that we know from Kamban and elsewhere. You know, it's almost like an abstract play: woman, husband, god one, god two. Ahalya, stones above the earth, beneath the earth, hillocks and mountains, rocks and fragments, standing upright, fallen down, stones. Her husband, the sage, was a stone. The god was a liar, but no stone he, only a male deity who lived to survive the curse. And she, who had lived like stone, coming alive for that instant alone, truly became a stone. On a day much later, a god who crossed the seas to rescue a lover, only to thrust her into burning flames, who feared the town's gossip and exiled her, an avatara unworthy of touching a stone, stumbled upon her. Had she not changed again, stone becoming woman, to live like a stone with a stone? Had she remained truly a stone, she might have stood forever, a mountain peak, undestroyed by time. In Sivasagaram's poem, all four characters are unnamed: the wife, the husband who curses her, god one and god two, one who's the reason for the curse, the other the means by which she's released from the curse. She's seen as the victim of all three. It's not the usual questions of Ahalya's morality and chastity that Sivasagaram takes up. He comes completely out of that, but of her right to a life of feeling, passion, and agency. The tragedy of Ahalya, as he sees it, is that she's condemned to be a stone, alive or not. The poem is very brilliantly and tightly organized around the image of stones and a complex set of meanings associated with and generated by stones. Besides this, it's constructed around a system of alliteration and play on similar sounding words: kal, stone; kal, foot; kalam, time; and so on. I'd like to spend a little time going through it, if you don't mind, if you're not bored out of your heads.
Can you just repeat kal?
Kal, kal, foot; kalam, time; and so on. Let's look at it closely, and I'm going to be referring to the Tamil as well. Karkal, stones, the single word, frames the first verse, containing a picture of rocky wasteland, which is again this fifth landscape, Pali, resounds through so much of the landscapes, resound through so much of modern Tamil. But stone also becomes a symbol, of course, for lack of feeling or passion. Hence, the first verse leads naturally into the second. And let me read the Tamil: Munivan Kanavan Kal, Devan Kayavan, Analum Illan Ikkal. Ironic repetition of Kal at the end of the lines and the alliteration of Kanavan, husband, Kayavan, liar, are ways of linking and contrasting the cold, morally correct sage Gautaman and the passionate but lying god Indran, who awakened Ahalya momentarily. A further contrast follows between the male deity who gets away with it. You'll remember Gautama's curse is partially repealed when the gods plead for him, and Ahalya, whose destiny is to become a stone. In her case, the curse will remain. Sivasekaram sees Ahalya as a victim of Gautama's coldness or stoniness in the first place. There's a peculiarly stinging irony in the content of the curse. Kallah, and I wish you could understand this, Kallaha vaandu, kananeram uyirndavalo, Kallahave anal. She who had lived like a stone, coming alive for that instant alone, Kallahave anal, truly became a stone. Once again, note the chiming repetition of that kal, this time at the beginning of the lines, enclosing the poignant kananeram uyirndavalo, came alive for an instant alone. The movement in the second half of the poem reverses what has gone before. The third verse balances the lying god Indra of the first half of the poem with the equally dubious god Rama, who's stumbling on Ahalya. It is actually Kal Idara. You understand that, Kal Idara? He just stumbles. It changes the whole character of the encounter between Rama and Ahalya. No longer an action of divine grace, it becomes a mere accident. And a nice balance between Kal and Kal here, by the way. The third verse also, with the two allusions, one to Sita's ordeal by fire and the other to her exile, casually subverts the whole of the Ramayana, as Pudhumaipithan, of course, did before him. Another symmetry here, Rama's brutal betrayal of his kadali, loved one. Thee pirambil talliyavan, one who thrust thee pirambil talliyavan, one who thrust or shoved her into the flames, is meant to parallel Indra's casual betrayal of Ahalya. The final lines magnificently turn the whole myth around, the accidental, indeed almost insulting deliverance from the curse. It leaves Ahalya condemned forever. No question of seeking salvation from a patriarchal god. In retrospect, had she at least been left a real stone, she would have had some dignity and stood for all time. Sivasekaram's poem not only retells the story, but signals towards a whole tradition of retellings and subversions, which are part of a Tamil literary history. Each retelling comes out of its particular time, and that's what is so wonderful, I think, raising questions which are relevant to that moment. But this becomes possible because of the strength of the story in the first place, the tangle of relationships and emotions, which can be seen in so many different ways from different perspectives, and the lasting questions it asks about moral choices and responsibilities. Thank you. When we were getting together our forthcoming book of Tamil poetry in translation, of course, we needed a piece from Kamban, What is Hamlet Without the Character? So we couldn't find a translation which we really loved, which we could absolutely fall in love with. And then we discussed what section we should take. And my colleague, Srilata, said, you know, we should go for the jugular. Go for the heart of the thing, the most important story, which is the fire ordeal. So I hummed and hawed and went and looked it up in Kamban, and I was absolutely enthralled. I think because it's so dramatically presented, I was surprised at how dramatic and theatrical both it is. And I think the psychological understanding, particularly in the portrayal of Sita's character, is quite amazing. It's breathtaking, in fact. So that's what I want you to look at. Remember that Rama has summoned Sita to the battlefield. It's a public place. So this first encounter after all this time is taking place in public. And it's not only the people around the Rakshasas and Hanuman's crowd, but also the gods. So there's a very wide cosmic audience. And of course, we too are watching this. So we are also another layer of audience. And it's very interesting that if you see it theatrically like that, that Kamban moves from one perspective to the other perspective. And then there's the audience intervention. So it's a beautiful piece of drama here. There's, of course, the dramatic conflict, the conflict between these two, which is a very private one, but it's also being enacted publicly. And that, of course, impacts on the whole scene. And I want to, I'll point out this use image of seeing eyes, gazing, looking, which is running all the way through in a very interesting way. I also find quite interestingly the human divine, the play between the human and divine, which, you know, all both the characters are moving between these two aspects of theirs. So let's go straight into it then. And this is the Michi Padalam, it is in Tamil, it ironically named Michi's Redemption, the Deliverance section. And I start us from the first time they actually see each other after the separation of a long time. Okay, so 57, I'm starting with. She saw him, his body leaf green, his mouth coral colored, his grape bow in his hand. And she, who was unblemished, thought, my body is polluted, bereft of life. What is there left for me to desire? Her instant feeling is of her unworthy state. That in the Tamil, the first line of the verse is yechil yen udal. Yechil yen udal. Uir egitre, my life is gone. And notice that Kamban immediately calls her the unblemished one. This kind of irony plays all the time. The unblemished one calls herself yechil, yechil yen udal. Moving on, I'm going to move on fairly fast because there's a lot here, and then we'll come back to whatever we want to. So these are for you, so feel free to scribble on them, do whatever you want, they're yours. Okay, she arrives in her chariot, surrounded by celestial beings. She arrived in her chariot, as if a false body deprived of dearest life, seeing it again, reaches out. So she went to him, her face unveiled. I want to pause a little bit at this. Pona per uirine kanda poyudal, the false body which sees at it's the great life that it has lost. And again we get this notion in Kamban that Rama is her very life. Literally almost her very life. So here she has been in her poi udal, the false body, which is now seeing its dearest life. It has been deprived of that all this time, reaching out to him. So she went to him. Notice her state of despair and him, absolutely beautiful. He's been in a battle, but there he is, body leaf green, his mouth coral colored, his bow in his hand. You know, he's absolutely there in all his greatness and beauty. And the great irony, now that I worship my Lord, my husband through all time, my husband beyond rebirth, were I to forget fall down and die, or whatever else befall me, yet all shall be well, she said, free of sorrow at last. An immense irony of that. All shall be well at last. Pirappinum thunaivanai, piravi peruda turappinum thunaivanai. She says, and let me, pirappinum thunaivanai, thunaivanai, piravi per idar turappinum, if beyond this life, all the time, he will be my husband. Torudu nan ini marappinum nandridu. Even if I should forget everything now, or fall down and die, it's all right, as she tells herself. And then we turn round to him, and he's gazing, looking. The Lord of all life gazed at her, queen of faithfulness, safeguard of womanhood, beauty of all beauties, essence of all fame, the very image of very image and embodiment of Dharma's grace. But this is how Kamban sees her, not as he sees her. He sees her, and Kamban is saying this is what she actually is, but that is not how he sees her. And the next verse, tears streaming down her breasts, like river, she bowed to him, lovely as a peacock, chastity's self, again Kamban commenting. And he watched, outraged, like a cobra rearing his head. I was amazed at this image. Panangin aravena erindu padpura. I mean, it's so dramatic. And my God, yes, like a cobra. And hear the sound of it. Panangila aravena erindu padpura. He raises his head and he looks. He gazes. Panangila ara, like a cobra with his head, with its hood open. He raises, looks at her. It's an amazing.
So, because of the peacock and the cobra,
yes,
sort of mythical enmity between them, no? The bird and the snake, and the peacock in particular, and it's very predatory.
Yes, yes, yes. And she in this vulnerable position, but the irony, you know, he builds her up. Katpinuk arasinai, penmai kaapinai, potpinuk arahinai, puharin varkei. You know, it builds up this beautiful image of this girl who is untouched, and then he looks at her like this. So you get Kamban's gaze and Rama's gaze. And then we get his absolute tirade, I can only say, against her. And let me read my translation and go over it in Tamil. You enjoyed your food. That's the first thing he says. You lived, you enjoyed your food. Though disgraced, you did not die. And this is what comes up again and again. How can you be still living? Why didn't you die, is what he's saying. That is the thread right through. Undiram uvandanai urukam par padam mandilai. You didn't die. You enjoyed your food. Though disgraced, you did not die. Fearless, you lived in the great city of the lawless Rakshasa, entirely submissive. So why come here now? Did you imagine I should still want you? Meanda then, why did you come back here? Ninai vinai virumbum enbado. Was it your thought that I would still love you, want you? This business of accusation about having enjoyed her food, of having lived, it's almost, Rama suggests, it's simply because she has survived, there is something deeply wrong with her. The assumption that to survive was wrong, and the absolute assumption that she was dishonored because she lived in this house, ate his food. Yes, yes. Isn't it amazing? Yes. When she says, "Yechel," and yes, you are. Yes, yes. Yes, yes, yes. Oh, yes. And then the central thing changes entirely his reason for coming to Lanka, not for her sake, but for his sake. It was not to save you that I bridged the sea, cut down to their root these Rakshasas with their lightning bright swords, destroyed them utterly, only to clear myself of blame, I came to Lanka. And it's repeated in the Tamil, you know, really quite beautifully, 63. Unnai meetpan porutu arithu. The first line is Unnai meetpan. Don't think that I came to redeem you. Unnai meetpan. Yennai meetpan porutu. Yennai meetpan porutu ilangai eidinen. The last line is to redeem myself, I came to Lanka. Not to redeem you, but to redeem myself, to redeem my honor. And the whole verse is framed in this Unnai meetpan. Yeah, name it, but. And remember the palalam is called Michi, to redeem, to deliver, to bring her back. Yeah, name it, for himself. And then again, this business, you've lived this long. The accusatory tone in 64. You who left me have lived so long eating the flesh of living things, sweeter to you than amrutam. This almost brackets her with the Rakshasas. You've become like them. You have eaten their food. You've eaten flesh. Drinking plentifully of toddy. Where does he get this from? Answer me now. What feasts will you prepare fit for us? This taunting. And you who, you know, he completely retells the story. You who left me, you know? Yemmei ninginai, it was you who left me. In the Tamil, the accusatory tone, marundunum inia mannuirin vantisai arundinaye. And the accusations come midline. Arundanaye, Naravameya undiye, Irundanaye, just to live, Irundanaye, just to be. How could you just, you know, just exist? That thing keeps coming again and again. You survived, you lived, you existed, Irundanaye. And then this, answer me, Urai. Answer me. And so the next line, I can hardly bear to read this. All virtues, precious as gemstones set into jewels, have fled you. Now you fulfill the auguries of your low birth, not of a noble clan were you born, but base as a worm out of the earth. You know, in the Tamil it is, Kulatinir pirandile, you weren't born in a noble clan. Kulam, noble clan. Kulatinir pirandile. Kol il kidam pol. Kidam is a worm. Kol il weak. Kol il kidam pol. Nilatinir pirandamai nirapinai. The you fulfilled the auguries of having been born in the earth. I find that about as insulting as you can get, really. Womanhood, greatness, noble birth, the steadfastness of chastity, good conduct, clarity, excellence, truth, all these have perished because you, woman, appeared on earth, vanished like the fame of a king who did not know to give gifts. And I should actually read that to you because you will understand it. Penmayum. Perumayum, pirappum, karpenum tinmayum, orukamum, telivum, seedmayum, unmayum, niyanum uruthi tondralal, vanmayin mannavan puharin maindalal, niyanum uruthi, because you, woman, tondralal, appeared on earth, all these have gone. It's completely over the top. It's unbelievable. And then this thing of you should have died. High-born women contain their five senses, constant in their virtuousness, their hair unbound. They offer up their vows of faithfulness. They wipe out a single scandal with their very lives. What more should I say? Your conduct cuts at the very root of understanding. What can you do now but die or go your way, wherever you choose, said Rama, wisdom of the wise. I always find these epithets very ironic, and I'm not sure whether the poet intends them to be quite as ironic, but they're always so apt. You know, wisdom of the, in this particular place that he calls him wisdom of the wise is surely tongue in cheek, is surely, pointing that up. The phrase in Tamil is Pulavar Bundiyan, he who sits in the hearts of the wise, Bundi, knowledge, understanding. I want to point to you this. Your conduct cuts at the very root of understanding. Let me read that a bit to you. It's 68. Yadi yan yambuvat unarvai eed ara seidian. What you have done has cut at the very root of it. Unarvai eed ara seidiai. It's unarvu, the word we were looking at the other day. Realization, understanding, intuition. I can't do this, he says. I can't understand. I can't reach out to what you... It really is beyond my understanding. My,
what is that line?
Yadiyan unarvai? Yadiyan yambuvadu unarvai eed ara seidi. So that is a whole cycle which ends there, Rama's retort, Rama's accusation. It goes on for those seven verses and stops there. And it's, remember, it's both a private accusation and a public one. It's very much both those. I think there's the personal feelings there of anger, pride, all that. And this thing of why didn't you die? Why didn't you, how could you have survived? How could you have eaten food in that house? Hadn't you become a Rakshasi almost? How could you with pride come before me now? What more, and it ends with what more should I say? Your conduct cuts at the very root. What can you do now but die? Sadil, Sadiyal Andi. What else can you do? And then you get a pause. And the public response, which in a way acts as a reminder of the significance of the two people. These are human, but they are also divine. Sages and immortals, multitudes of men gathered there besides all the Rakshasas, all monkeys, and the entire animal world raised a great cry of despair. You're always aware of this audience, you know, this cosmic audience, looking on to what is both very private and very public. And Kamban moves, as I said, between this all the time. Then we move now to Sita's perspective. And here we're back now to the intensely personal and private response. Sita, lotus-seated Lakshmi incarnate, looked earthwards, eyes streaming blood and tears, as if a wound within her were stirred with a stick. Almost unconscious, her senses slipping, she gave a great sigh. And the image, it's really physical pain she's feeling there. As if a wound had been stirred. Punninai kol urutanaya. See how very, very physical, yes, with a stick, an open wound is being stirred, and it's like that she feels. The commentator, by the way, suggests that her eyes are streaming blood and tears, blood of anger, tears of sorrow. So both those are intended there. And even that is very physical too. She's, her eyes are streaming blood and tears. And this very physical pain she feels. Remember, Kamban is always telling us that Rama is, as it were, her very life. So this is that extreme physical pain. The next verse I find very moving, and I want to stop a bit at that. Like a deer in a desert waste, wheeled about by kites, tortured by thirst to the point of death, who sees a lake but cannot reach its waters, so she saw in shocked distress the obstacles ahead of her. When you read that word, that phrase, desert waste, you know immediately that it's Pali. And we're all familiar with Pali now, the place of rejection. And you know, it's also a place of the dead, desert waste, wheeled about with kites. So it's also bringing us back to the battlefield. It connects both the battlefield, the here and now, and this inner landscape. Like a deer in a desert waste, wheeled about by kites, tortured by thirst to the point of death. And then this reaching out but not being able to touch the waters, who sees a lake but cannot reach its waters. And it's this distress, the despair that we are getting all the time in Sita's case. Almost physical pain and extreme distress. Because she understands that, you know, there are huge obstacles now, and how is she going to get beyond that? Is she going to be able to get beyond that? There's no sense at all of her ever thinking until it's all over that actually she can get through this. You know, it's that state of extreme despair, as we will see as the verses go on. So now we come to the verses where it's her turn to address him and address the world. Now, whereas his accusation is addressed directly to her, retort, her reply is calling to witness the audience, the cosmic audience, and then she turns to him. First, she addressed the world, stunned, wide eyes, red streaked, raining tears. So this much, it seems, is all I'm to gain. For all the years I have lived, today my store of merit ends. It's again this extreme. Extreme despair. Ittathu polum yan irundhu petra peru uttadal en tavam. Ittathu polum. This is. It looks. It appears to be that all the worldly gain I have earned is ended now. Ittathu polum yan irundhu petra peru. Uttadal Yantavam, because my store of merit is now ended. It really is as if she, you know, she is looking to, he's told her to die. And it's as if she accepts that. There's no question of proving her innocence at this point. I was really interested to see that she's not saying, you know, can you understand, how can you accuse me of this? It's completely unreasonable. She just accepts that, you know, once he has said all this, it's total despair. There's nothing else I can do but die. You know? Then she turns, you know, she addresses the world to say, it looks as if this is it. My fate has handed to me this. So my merit ends here, and so this is what I have to do. Then she turns to him, and this is her only comeback to him. When Maruti came, he assured me, you, my lord, were hastening here to rescue me. He who is most upright, did he not tell you of my state, how I was slowly dying of despair? Was he not a true messenger? It's her only comeback is this. And it also is by way of saying, I was alive because he told me you were coming. I survived because he told me you were coming to rescue me. Did he not tell you, did it not come back with that message to you? Was he not a true messenger? It's her only self-defense. And it's couched in such a way that she doesn't directly say how mad and unreasonable you are. She only says, did he not tell you that I was dying of despair? And because he told me you were coming to rescue me, I remained alive for that. Notice the next verse. All my discipline, all my good deeds, the chastity I safeguarded for so long, so arduously, all this seems but madness. Pittam is the word she uses. Pittam is craziness. It seems crazy. A futile and mistaken waste, since you, most excellent one, cannot intuit it in your heart. The word she uses is unerdl. Maruthi vandhanai kandu, vallanni sarudhi indana samaya solinan. Yarinum menmayan isaitad ilayo. Sorumennilaya, avan thudum allano. Was he not a good thudan? Did he not marudan vandanai kandu, vallan ni sarudhi indana? That you, my lord, would come and rescue me. Vallan ni sarudhi indana, samaya solinan. He told me that to comfort me. You who are above all, yarinum menmayan isaitadilayo. Didn't he tell you this? Sorum yennilai avan thudum allano. Was he not a true messenger? And then this, since you, most excellent one, cannot intuit it in your heart. 74 it is. Yattavam yennalam yenna karpu naan ittanai kaalamam urandu veedalam pittanalar avam pilaithal endre uttaman nee manad unarndilamaya. You didn't understand it, you didn't intuit. Unarvu, it is that intuitive understanding that he is lacking. She is accusing him of lacking, which is, I'll say something more about that. It's interesting too that she says that everything that I've stood for seems a waste. It seems crazy that I have been faithful to him so, faithful to you so long. And what is the use of my having been faithful to you so long if you don't understand it in your heart? You know, there's no point in my arguing with it, is what she's saying. And the next verse, foolish as I am, the whole world knows I'm a Patini. I would not change my mind, not even for Brahma, he of the lotus. But if my Lord, who is the world's eye, denies it, then what God is left to convince him otherwise? And notice that thing about the eye. You who are, if he who is the world, if my Lord who is the world's eye denies it, ar kelam kan is how she puts it. For everyone's eye, the world's eye. And the commentator says, it's interesting, the eye of divine wisdom, the all-seeing eye, the sun that grants vision to all, the eye that grants inner perception. But I think also, you know, it is, in Tamil, it is, Aad kelam kannavan endal adit kannavan, Aad kelam kannavan. He who is the eye of all things, dearest the eye. Remember we say Kannan, Krishna, Raman, Vishnu, Kannan, dear as the eye, who cherishes all, who is the eye. And she gives, you know, it's so much about seeing perception, seeing, gazing, perception. And so when she calls him the world's eye here, it resonates in a very special and particular way. And the next verse.
Can I ask about Patini, please?
Yes.
Why did you not translate it?
How does one translate Patini? I think it's one of those notions that that is very difficult to translate. Yeah. And I would always keep conceptual things like that.
Like dharma, for example.
Yes, yeah. Yes, we do keep dharma. And I think Patini has a very special resonance, which, you know, faithful wife would just not get. So, and it says Patini, and I've kept it like that. All the world knows I'm a
Patini. What is the root of this Patini? Patini.
It's not a Tamil. It's a.
Sanskrit.
It is Sanskrit, yes. Patini. It is taken completely over from the Sanskrit and used in. He uses equally katpu for chastity, which is the Tamil notion, and that katpu karasi, you know, the queen of chastity, that comes up again. Katpu is the word that's used. And katpu is not abstention, but katpu is chastity, faithfulness, always in the Tamil frame. So,
katpu, is it
katpu?
Katpu. The black.
No, that is karupu. Karupu. Katpu is a special word.
Okay.
Yes, in classical times, katpu, always. It can still be used, Karpu, in that sense.
No, like I was only wondering, Pati Patni. So Pati is actually one who is the husband, but
Pati
still one
is
who's the
Lord. Yes.
Same way, Patini, is there something? Patni is something. Even in Sanskrit, I was wondering whether there is any meaning for it.
No, it's Pati Patini, yes, but. Okay, I just want to take the next verse and then pause a little. He of the lotus, he who rides the bull and he who carries the conch, that Mamurti himself, all three may perceive all things in the universe like the nelly fruit in the palm of the hand. But can they see into a woman's heart? And again, it's I'm really quite. I find this quite moving. What she is saying, because isn't she saying that unardal, this ability to understand, to intuit, to perceive the heart, is this a human quality which is missing in the gods? As far as this version is concerned, so far she's aligning herself with women, Mangayar. And she is in that position, she's saying, in the gods. It seems that the gods can't see into a woman's heart. And it leads from, if my Lord, who is the world's eye, denies it. And the earlier verse, since you, most excellent one, cannot intuit it in your heart. To intuit, to perceive, to see. These are the resonating words. And it seems to me that what she's saying is almost that, it seems that you gods can't do this. Is this a human quality then, which you gods don't seem to have? The lineup of the human and the divine is another thing that's going on in this whole sequence, although the crossover also happens, so that up to a point Sita has aligned herself with human women, Mangayar. But then gradually she no longer is human, but shifts into the divine, and her divinity is asserted. And it seems to me her divinity is asserted before Rama actually understands his own divinity, which is quite, isn't that quite interesting in the whole movement of this? Yes, please.
Even in Valmiki, it's that same thing. Shuman in Summer suggests that it's the revelation of her divinity, which she already has an understanding of. Mm. It's the public revelation of her divinity that makes it possible for him to see his own.
It's that way. It really is that way it happens. But it's very interesting that you have this human encounter. And Sita's despair is completely human. And that parlay thing, it resonates with Sangam. It's a love poem as well, this. And the parlay thing very much aligns it with love, aham poetry. Later on, we'll have an alignment with bhakti, at the end of the sequence. But very much this bit is that lover's estrangement. And her despair is because she cannot get to him. And there's no point in reasoning with him as well. Maruti failed, her, just as he keeps saying, God's sake, why didn't you die? She keeps telling herself, if he can't understand my heart, if he can't see into that, he who is the world, then what's the point of argument? And it looks as if it's not just him, but the whole jing-bang lot of them don't have that understanding of the human heart, which is quite an indictment, I think, and the lining up of what humans can do and what the divine are able to do and cannot do. Then the 77, which comes to the end of her sequence, and note the balance between his sequence, the intervention of the cosmic audience, and then we came to her sequence. And that last verse of the sequence, 77, where she says, therefore now, to whom should I protest my innocence further? The noblest thing for me is to die. Your command, who are the Veda's word, is fitting. And this is my fate. And again, the epithet, always you who are the here. And it always rings with irony. And yet it's apt in that particular place. So, again, I think a striking thing is that she's not making a great gesture, she's not saying, I will prove to you, or reason with him, or any of that. It's as if she's entering the fire in despair. And then she summons. And of course, he never asks for proof either. He takes it absolutely for granted that she has been dishonored and brings those terrible accusations against her, unreasonable. And so she then summons Lakshmana to light the fire. And he, heavy-hearted, bowed to Rama, world's refuge, who gave his permission, speaking with his eyes. And there's another, this lovely thing. Let me give you Kannil Kurinan, literally spoke to it with his eyes. And he just gestures with his eyes, and that's it. Lakshmana, poor fellow, weeping bitterly, lights the fire. I've left out three verses here, but...
Yes,
that is a repeated image, of course. And all these heavy jewels, which are too much for her to bear always. Let me just briefly tell you, because now, from 79, we get the public entering, the intervention of the audience. And it's here in this intervention that her divinity begins to make itself felt. You know, I think so far we've been so aware of the human Sita, and I think we entirely sympathize. You know, there is that we are taken into her heart and her feelings, I think. And we are with her. And then slowly she shifts away. Her divinity begins to assert itself. And I think the cosmic reaction is what sets that divinity into play, as it were. And let me summarize for you very briefly those verses. 80, she's addressed as the mother of the gods, Devar Kumtai, the audience is unable to endure the sight of her approaching the fire, because as we have the audience reaction, we also have the movement of her going round the fire. She goes round the fire and she bows to Rama and then enters. So while this movement is going on, we get the reaction from the audience. All creatures as well as the four Vedas and Aram itself, Aram is the Tamil word for Dharma, itself begin to raise their voices. And in 81, as she is circumambulating the fire, all creatures of the sky and earth, Van Mudal Ulahavum Uyirhalam, lament. And they're actually addressing Rama and saying, Ayya Ichalam Iditakkadaladu. Your extreme anger is not fitting. Then in 82, Indra's wives and all the heavenly creatures are beating their eyes. And in 83, Brahma and the principal gods themselves are trembling. Adisesha also begins to shake, and the whole earth begins to tremble. The sun and stars lose their appointed places, and the oceans weep. So you get this absolute cosmic reaction to what is going. There's, you know, tension. We know the story, but nevertheless, there is that tension. And Sita is quietly circumambulating the fire at this time. And then she, we come back to her words now. The human tragedy is very soon moving into a miracle. Her jewels heavy upon her breasts and arms, she called out, "Lord Agni, if I have erred in thought or deed, let your fury burn me." She turned and bowed to her husband, he who wears the tulasi garland. Even now, she's not saying, "Prove me pure." She puts it the other way. If I have erred in thought and in deed, then burn me. And then this next verse is quite amazing, and I want to take that a little slowly. As if she were returning to her palace upon the lotus, which rises above deep waters, she leapt within. At once the fire itself was scorched like milk-white cotton, instantly ablaze by the flames of her chastity. Look at the drama and movement of this verse. In the Tamil, it says, Neendarum punal idai nivanda tamarai eindana koyile eiduvalana. As if she would go to her own palace, koyile eiduvalana. The word koil in Tamil comes from koil, the dwelling place of the king, which becomes transferred to the temple later. But here it is still koil, the yes, ill, as in illam, and ko is the king. Yeah. It is the dwelling place of the as if she were returning, to reaching out and returning to her own koil, which is held up by the lotus, in deep waters. Eiduvalena paindanal. That is the word. She leaps into the water. Paindanal, you know this word, paindanal. To leap, to plunge in. There's a sense of force, volition. There's also anger. It's almost a violent word. Paindanal, you know, a tiger can Pailam, it's that sort of, the word.
It's the same word as Payampuli.
Yes, yeah. Payampuli, Paindanal. It comes at the beginning of the word. Neendarum punayilai nivandha thamarai eindana koyile eiduvalana paindanal. And there's that dramatic pause, which he does so well. Paindanal. Paidalum. As soon as she does that, panjana teenda eri aval katpintina, by the fire of her chastity, the flames itself are scorched. So just look at what's happening. Fire becomes water. You know, she leaps into the waters. She plunges in as if she were swimming towards her own home in the deep waters, from which the lotus holds up her palace. There's that dramatic pause after paindanal, and then there's the real flame. Paidalum palin panjana, like milk white cotton. The fire itself is scorched by the fire of her chastity. So there's the real fire, the fire of her chastity, and the fire becoming water. I mean, it's a magnificent verse, I think. And it's that volition, it's her anger, her despair, all those feelings. But going to her own home, her divinity is now asserting itself. It's there, you know. And it's so naturally said. And then that's it. I must say that there is also, to me, a glance at Carnegie. the fire of her chastity. It's that Tamil memory and the Tamil story. Remember Shilapadiharam, end of Sangam. It's that feeding in and Sangam love poems and that business of parley feeding in. Surely this is Kannagi's fury. We remember the fire of her chastity that burnt Madurai, and the fire of her chastity here, Sita's flames of chastity scorching Agni himself. I think it's magnificent that. And there's no victim, you know? It's this woman who's goddess, who's also anger itself, despair, anger, all those things. She, her words are always so quiet. Lord Agni, if I have erred in thought indeed, let your fury burn me. It's very dignified. It's very quiet. But it's her actions that give away her anger, I think. And then Agni begins his witness. Of course, you've noticed that it's not Agni who burns Sita, but Sita who burns Agni. It's a kind of turnaround of that. So Agni rose up, lifting in his hand. The Tamil name Agni becomes Angi, by the way. I thought you might be like that. Angi. Angi, yes. It's not that Angi. Angi, I think it's the inversion of the sound. Agni becomes Angi.
So this is very ritualistic also, use of Angi.
Yes, but it's not, I don't think, it's a different, yeah. It's we know Angi, but it's Angi is the name. So he begins his witness by bringing her up. Agni rose up, lifting in his hands, she who had plunged into his flames, himself burnt by her fire. Distressed, crying out in pain, Agni bowed in worship to the source of all wisdom. Arattu, Pusal Arattu, he's really calling out in torture. And he displays, he talks about her anger. We've not seen in her words her anger, as I said, but through the witness of Agni and through her own action, I think that paidal is quite amazing. But here's Agni, he's saying, her anger at your rejection drew beads of sweat upon her body. Look, they have not dried yet. Bees surround the flowers in her hair. They drip honey as though newly steeped in water. What more need I say? Udin Sitram, her anger at your rejection. Also, Udal is another of these Sangam words. Lovers' estrangement and resentment, all those are udal. So it brings it back to a love story and an estrangement between human lovers too. It's always there as well, this Kamban's telling as a love poem. Another pause, and we come back to the cosmic audience. The three worlds so rudely shaken stood upright again. All living things, grief-stricken, let go their fear. Arundhati and others danced, casting away modesty. I love that little touch. And, you know, movement too, and you get this lovely bit of...
Stars.
Yes, yes, dancing. This lovely touch that Arundhati and the other Mahalir, the women, the females, leave aside Narnam and Purai. Mm-hmm. Narnam, modesty, shame, when they frolic in this way.
She's also
the star of faithfulness. Quite interesting that Arundhati is evoked here. The thought of Arundhati dancing shamelessly is rather a lovely touch, I think. Then we begin. We begin Agni's witness. And he begins with a muraidu, a complaint, as if in a court. You know, the word used is muraidu, his almost legal complaint. Were you not aware you would destroy my power through the divine flames of her high and pure chastity? Why were you furious with me too, I who am blameless? So, you know, this needless inflicting of pain upon Agni himself. But Rama is too far gone, you see. Look at this amazing thing that he says, and who are you? In an instant, Rama, who are you? What is it you say rising from the fire? As if he's not recognizing Agni, but somebody else. You refuse to destroy this wicked woman, praising her instead. Who instructed you? Answer me. Again, it's quite insulting and rude. Urai, tell me. Annadar solli, sollai eed araidiyal endran. It's almost like a conspiracy theory, you know. He can't, even now he can't accept. He refuses to recognize Agni. He can only think that, you know, somebody told you. He'd rather believe in a conspiracy theory than accept what is in front of his eyes.
But the actual beauty of the whole thing is, according to any Puranas or anything, if you put something into fire, and if it comes out, it's purified, whether it's gold or whatever it is. And you know, this man, even after she's put into fire and comes out, cannot accept that she's pure. Then he will not accept anything else. If the fire's judgment is not accepted.
Well, the witness by fire comes immediately after this. There's a very dignified statement by Agni, you know, saying who he is and why he has been why the fire has been established as the witness of all things. Yes, exactly. Yes. 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 And it's a completely gratuitous. Yes. So it's as when Kamban says it's a muraidu, it's a complaint that's made in a court almost. You know, he starts by saying, "You've done this to me, who am blameless." Of course, he's shown Sita in her state of complete, you know, freshness and beauty. Nothing about her has been singed. In fact, the garlands are fresh. The water is still there. The water in which the flowers were steeped are still there. And he's shown her, and has said, "What more need I say?" And then it's the complaint. You have hurt me, who am completely blameless. But then he leaves that aside and then goes on to, when he says, who instructed you, answer me. And there is this very dignified protest by Agni, first almost stating his credentials. I'm Agni, I stand here because I could not withstand the burning flames of this lady's chastity. Again, the flames of chastity, the flames which actually overcome Agni himself. After all you have seen, again, this thing of what is in front of you, world's eye, seeing, perceiving, perception, what you see but can't actually understand in your heart, all those things. After all you have seen, can you still doubt her? You who are witness to all. Thank you.